So the options on interest rate future is the next area of this question, the options on interest rate futures. Now let's see. Remember, it's options on interest rate futures. It's option on futures. It's not interest rate options. It's options on futures. That means when it's an option on future, so you've got two types of option, call options and the put options. Call option is an option to buy, put option is an option to sell. Always remember that the lender would actually go for call option and the borrower would go for put option. Always remember that the lender would go for call option and the borrower would go for put option. Now, so what exactly is this option? This option is giving us a right to buy or a right to sell the interest rate futures. How do we construct the hedge on interest rate? How do we construct the hedge on options on interest rate futures? So that is something that actually needs to be seen. Let's try to understand. So when we talk about constructing an options hedge, is number one is which contracts. Now what do we mean by this? Call or put. Number two is which maturities. Number three is number of contracts. Number four is what is strike price. So this is what you have. Constructing an options hedge, which contract, which maturity, number of contracts, what is strike or exercise price. This is what you have. Now, so how do we construct the options hedge? That's important. In this case, you know you're a lender. You know you're a lender. So when you're a lender, because vertical company, you're a lender. So basically what happens is you'll go for a call options. Which maturity? The same is the case as it was with the interest rate futures, which is basically the contract whose maturity is immediately after the borrowing or the lending date. So we've got contract whose maturity is immediately, we've got match contract. We'll go for match contract. Okay, somebody is asking that why is it a call option? Okay, so let me try to help you, because what happens is there are actually two types of option. One of them is called cap and the other one of them is called floor. So the cap, it fixes the maximum rate and it is for the borrower. Cap fixes the maximum rate and it is for borrower. Floor fixes the minimum rate and it is for lenders. So basically what happens is when we talk about the lenders, so lenders, what they would want is they would want to buy this rate. They would want to buy this rate. They would want to say that we want this rate. And as a borrower, he would want to pay this rate. So for buy, you call. For payment, you put. That's why it's a call option for the lender. Number two, which maturity? It's going to be match maturity. Why? Because always remember, the contract whose maturity is immediately after your borrowing or lending date is the contract which you are going to go for. So you've got which contract, you've got which maturity. And then the number of contracts. You calculate the number of contracts in the same manner as you do it for the interest rate futures. How? You say the amount divided by size, multiply by time period, multiply by, divide by the maturity period. So it's actually going to be D 27 million divided by D 0.5 million, multiply by 5 divided by 3. So that gives you 90 contracts. Now, lastly, what strike price will you go for? That's very important. Now you see, you try to understand this specific table. In this specific table, you need to first of all understand this portion of the table only. It's actually when you have a strike price of 94.25 and you go for a call option with December, so you end up paying this much premium. And this premium is also in percentage terms. This premium is also in percentage terms. This premium is also in percentage terms. Now, so it means if you go for 94.25, you pay this premium. You go for 94.25 March option, you pay this premium. 94.25 June, this premium. Now let's try to understand. So basically, how do we establish the strike price? First of all, you would say 94.25 or 95.25. This 94.25 is actually 5.75. And this is actually 4.75 because it's 100 minus R, it becomes 5.75, it becomes 4.75. Now let's try to establish. So as a lender, we will receive this amount. This is going to be your receipt. And the premium is paid out of your pocket. It's 5.545%. This is also percent. This is also percent. This is 0.098%. You receive the interest and you pay premium. So resultingly, what happens is, five point two zero 5%. This is called net rate. And this is 4.652%. This is called net rate. So as a lender, what would you want to do? You would want to maximize your net rate. You would want to go for this net rate. And for that, you'll have to 94.25. Now there are two ways of attempting this type of a question in exam. Examiner actually asks you that you can demonstrate the working using both ways. You can either demonstrate the working using both the strike price, or you can demonstrate the working using either of the strike price. But for that strike price, you need to demonstrate how did you establish a one single strike price. So as I do it by establishing one single strike price. How? I knew that I'm a lender, so that means I'm going to receive this interest, and the premium is paid, so it's going to be an outflow. So this is how the net rate is established. Now let's see. So the strike price is 94.25. So on 1st of October, you've been able to establish a hedge. What? By 90 March, all options at strike price of 95.25. At 95.2, 94.25, sorry, 94.25. So on 1st October, this is how your hedge has been created. Your hedge has been created. And when you do these things, you get 4 marks. You get 4 marks for doing this only, which is establishing the number of contracts, the relevant month, the relevant type of the contract, and the strike price. You get 4 marks for it. Okay, let's move forward. So you establish the hedge. What would you do on 31st January when you will have a lending date? What would you do? So there are two situations. Either the spot rate would increase by 1.1% or they would decrease by 0.6%. So it is either going to be 5.3% or it is either going to be 3.6%. This is what the spot is going to be. The price of the interest rate future in the market, how do we establish that? So remember, there are options on interest rate futures. The closeout price that we establish for the interest rate future, the closeout price that we establish for the interest rate futures is going to be the prevalent price of the futures in the market right now. So what was the price that we established? We established two prices. One of them was 94.36, the other one of them was 96.06. And you have a call option on 94.25. Now, what do you mean by this? That means this is the rate prevalent in the market. This is the rate prevalent in the market. This is the market rate. This is the market rate. And this is the strike price. This is the strike price. I repeat it again. This is the market rate and this is strike price. This is market rate, this is strike. You need to decide on this 31st Jan only whether you are actually going to exercise your option or not. Now remember, how do we make a gain? How do we make a gain? We make a gain by buying at a low price and selling at a high price. So if we do it this way here, we get a gain. If we do it this way, we get a gain. How much is going to be the gain that we would get? 94.36 less 94.25. So this actually gives you 0.11%. And this one gives you 1.81%. Is everyone okay till here? Is everyone okay that why did we exercise and how did we actually ended up getting a gain on this interest rate futures options? So now we have got this gain on the interest rate options. So we now need to conclude the interest rate options scenario. The interest income, I'm not going to be calculating the whole income again because we've already done it with the interest rate futures and with the FRA 560 to 500, and interest income here is going to be 371,250. The gain on options is 0.11% into 90 into 500,000 into 3 upon 12. Here gain on options 1.81% into 90 into 500,000 into 3 upon 12. So basically what is going to happen? Mm-hmm. So it's 12,375, which is the gain. And in the other situation, it's going to be 203,625. And then you have got the premium. You've got the option premium. So when we talk about the option premium, how much is the option premium are we going to be paying? So we need to establish that. The option premium we are going to be paying is 0.545. So it's going to be 0.545%. into 90 into 500,000 into 3 upon 12. So it's going to be 61313 approximate. And the premium is going to be an outflow. So resultingly, what has happened is, $513,562 is what you have achieved. Now, if I say that what is the net rate achieved, so it's actually going to be 513,562 divided by 27 million multiplied by 12 divided by 5. So gives you 4.565%. Gives you 4.565%. Now, if I try to establish that what was the net rate that we had calculated, so we had calculated 5.205. But what have we got? We've got 4.565%. Now, this rate is not the same as the rate that we had predicted. This is not the same rate as we had predicted. Why? Okay, there is actually a reason behind that. And what is that reason? The reason is the remaining basis of these, or the remaining basis of the spread. So now if I say at 0.3, which is the credit spread, so what? How much do you get? 4.565 plus 0.3. So you end up getting 4.865. It's still not the same. Okay. Add a 0.34% to it. Why? Because this is what the remaining basis is. So it will become 5.205. What did I do? I did nothing. I simply calculated this 513,562 into an annualized interest rate. I added a 0.3% as a credit spread because, so I ended up getting 4.865% as the interbank rate that we have achieved. And why is it different to the net rate that we had originally expected? Because of the basis. So we added the basis to it. We ended up getting 5.205. So in future, if you come across a question of options, which is not that, which does not carry that many marks, what can you do? You can do a four-step calculation to the options question. This is which contract, which maturity, number of contract, which is strike price. And after the strike price, you could actually calculate that what is going to be the net rate that is going to be achieved. So how the strike price, and then you can adjust it for the remaining basis and then adjust it for the credit spread and you'll end up getting it. So I hope that everybody is okay with it also. Okay, so here we have actually been able to calculate the interest rate options also. Resultingly, what have we got? So if I talked about the interest rate future, the forward rate agreements, we had 5.02%. If I talked about the interest rate futures, we had 4.88%. And now when I talk about the interest rate options, we had 4.865%. So resultingly, the best is, in fact, we had this 4.865%. So resultingly, the best thing to do is go for the FRA, the forward rate agreement. Okay, that's great. So we are done with this question, which is Verdigo company.